exciting programs, but that's not why I'm here today. I'm here to invite our co-hosts that are helping us run this program. That is the Startup Leadership Program. And that event today, we have six different entrepreneurs who are going to be talking over here and telling us about the pitfalls and challenges, the success stories, what worked, what did not work. And to moderate that, I have Dr. Ashish Mehra over here moderating this event. It's my pleasure to introduce him today. Let me tell you just a short brief, give a brief introduction on him. Ashish is an experienced leader and entrepreneur with about 18 years of experience. His experience spans in business and engineering leadership, and hiring and building teams, doing people and program management, customer engagements. He's got experience with early stage startups, fundraising, software development, product innovation, and advanced research. He holds a MSE and PhD degree in computer science and engineering from the University of Michigan at Ann Arbor, and three guesses where he got his BTech from. IIT. He got his electrical engineering BTech degree from IIT Kanpur. He's an author of three US patents, over 20 published papers, and he's also the member of IEEE. So please join me in welcoming Ashish Mehra, who's not only a leader, mentor, advisor, guide, and entrepreneur, but also an author and a published author, that too. So let's give him a big hand and welcome him. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, thanks for that wonderful introduction. I was not expecting that, so I appreciate that. But I'm here to actually represent the Startup Leadership Program in a different capacity. I'm the program lead for the Startup Leadership Program, the Silicon Valley chapter. And we are hosting this event, co-hosting with Ty. Really a pleasure. Ty has been a great partner for us over the years, not only for this event, but even prior. When we do run our classes, they actually are a very good partner with some of the key people in Ty, including facilities and so on. So they're hosting this event, and we really appreciate that. I'm going to talk about the topic for today is start wise, stay wise. I think that says it all. In this environment, or in any environment, you really want to be able to make the right choices and react in the right way. And it's all about startup leadership, and therefore the plug for SLP, which I'll talk about. Before I get started with the actual program and invite the panelists, I would like to talk about SLP a little bit. It's a global group. We are a nonprofit in many countries. I'll talk about some stats. But really, if you are a first-time entrepreneur, or if you have some idea that you're seriously pursuing, you might be a founder who is an early-stage founder who is good at certain things but not good at some other things. You might be even a post-traction founder who wants to hone your skills in various aspects. Not everybody is born with all the traits and all the skills. You have to acquire them. Or you just want to grow your network. You have maybe a MVP that you want to convert into a business. All of these things require startup leadership. And therefore, the SLP program is very appropriate for you. Now, why does it matter? Because startups are all about two main things: preparation and execution. And the execution part is you as the entrepreneur are going to do that. But we believe in SLP that we focus on you. And our mission is simple: to build the next generation of startup leaders and CEOs. We provide a world-class education. So it's like a mini MBA for startups. We focus on you. So if you want to go from point A to point B, I like to give this example. And the startup is like the vehicle, and you are the driver. So we want to make sure that you have the right skills. Because a startup, doing a startup, or even deciding to do a startup, is all about, first of all, making decisions. And second, about making good decisions and reacting to what you're seeing happen in real time. You're putting a lot on the line: money, family, time, health. So much is on the line for your passion, your belief, and the opportunity. So very important to actually do it right. So we build your know-how, your skills, and your network. We take no equity, but there's a nominal fee. And this is an education in a very collaborative setting, interactive setting. So you can do online courses all day long. You can read online all day long. Ton of material out there. But if you want an environment where you can interact with the cohort and learn from each other and get tons of good feedback, then this is a very good program for you. It does give you a lifetime global network, not only through our network, but through partners like TI. And this is key, and this aligns with the TI mission also that Deepti talked about, which is we inspire you to give back. I'm volunteering in this capacity, and therefore I'm giving back. And that's key, that giving back is the essence and the ethos. All of the program at SLP are actually run by volunteers. Worldwide, more than 2,200 fellows across 27 cities with more than 12 countries collectively raised over $500 million, more than 45 exits, collectively more than 1,300 startups. At your tables, there's a flyer everywhere. Pick one up, please. Take with you, think about it. If you are really doing a startup, or if you know somebody who's doing a startup, please spread the word. It's a very good program. And so also on the tables, there are sign-up sheets. We'd love to know who was here. And if you can just write your name, your email address, at every table there is a sign-up sheet and a pen. And if you don't have a name tag, there are name tags also. So if you can do that, I would like to give you some more information very quickly on what we actually do. So if you do join the program, what do you get? It's 80 hours of evening and weekend classes. We don't do it every week. It's every other week, 3 hours. And then some weekends, maybe three or maybe four, day-long workshops and classes. And it's a very interactive and energizing environment. I want to emphasize that because you learn, you apply, and you get feedback. And those three things in a collaborative environment, you simply cannot get elsewhere. And it's not a competitive environment, it's not a pressure cooker, it's actually designed to help you collaborate. We do bring in seasoned entrepreneurs, mentors, including TI members and others, to give their perspectives and insights. And it's fascinating to hear from them. You'll hear from some of them actually on the panel today. We cover various topics. I'm sure you've heard of Lean Startup, customer development. There are so many issues that you have to learn about, legal issues, team issues, pitching. I mean, having a good story to tell and then being able to tell well is the essence of whether you attract customers, whether you attract investors, or whether you attract partners. Simulations, we don't just sit there and talk just one way. These are simulations. These are designed around, for example, rapid prototyping. How do you take an idea and create a business out of it, at least the outlines of a business within a weekend? And then you build from there. How do you do term sheet competitions? How do you understand term sheets? And literally be in pressure situations where there are VCs who are role-playing, and also competition we've had in this room, actually. A day long, fascinating, with actual VCs judging right here. So it's a high pressure environment. You are thinking on your feet, but you're also planning to convince them to give their money to you. So you got to understand what are they expecting. And then of course, network. It's all about network. Outside of you and your idea, the more you expand out to your product, your business, your ecosystem, your story, you'll realize that it's not a single person's journey. It takes a whole ecosystem to be successful, and we give you that. Lots of exits. There will be a quiz at the end. I'm kidding. But we are accepting applications. August 1st is the deadline, so please, those flyers, you can find all the information you need. If you know people who are interested, or if you're interested, please apply. And with that, I'll move on to the actual panel. I'm very excited about this panel because this panel represents as you will see when the panelists come out here, it's a very diverse set of startups. We wanted to get founders up here, but the diversity is in multiple dimensions. There are different markets, consumer and enterprise. There are different sectors, medical devices, machine learning, parking navigation, home security. There are different stages they are in. Somebody has just jumped in a few months ago. Somebody's out there trying to raise money in this environment. Somebody's already raised some money and they're moving on to the next stage. And somebody has exited and actually had success, not once, but twice. So it's a very good perspective you'll get from all different angles, which I'm really very excited about that. And they all represent different ways of starting out, which you will hear about. So with that, it's my pleasure, my distinct pleasure to invite all the panelists to please come on the stage. We have Ilker, Shiv Agarwal, and we have Eyal Amir, and JR, Shweta and Ashwin. Welcome. Please give a big round of applause for the panelists. So the temperature is a little bit high, and as Dipti said, we're going to make it hotter. But actually, these are all cool startups, so it'll cool down, trust me. I'm going to ask questions to the audience for the next maybe half an hour or so, and then we'll open up for audience Q&A as well. We will go and, I think, go over beyond 8:30. Like, we just love to talk, or at least, you know, gather the insights. So maybe you'll go a little beyond 8, maybe go to 8:40, 8:45, and then open up for Q&A, I mean, for networking. I want to start by just giving each of you a quick 30-second intro about who you are, what do you do, and generally, very quickly, what's your journey been from wherever you were to being an entrepreneur today? So let's start from the left, my left.
Good evening, everyone. This warm day here. My name is Ilker Kinnear. I am the co-founder and CEO of a very recently founded startup, Tinidos Networks. We do Internet of Things security. We create a security appliance for the home that will
protect a home and the families from all cyber threats. My background, I spent 15 years in Cisco in multiple different roles in multiple different countries. Most of that it's spent on security. Most recently, I was at Office of the CTO for Security Solutions. I was designing the latest threat intelligence offer from Cisco. So I'm all about security. I spent pretty much all my entire career on security. I was in the last year's program for SLP. We were cohorts with Ashish and many others here. So that's just part of the experience that I would like to talk about. And I want to leave it there, and I'm sure there will be more opportunity to talk about my experience and the questions.
Hi, everyone. My name is Shiv Agarwal, and till last month, I was the co-founder and CEO of a data analytics startup. It was called Arkin, and just last month, it was acquired by VMware. I graduated from IIT Kanpur back in late 90s. I've been in US for almost like 15, 16 years now. Major part of my career has been in startups, background in security, data centers, et cetera. And I was part of the SLP program in the 2012-2013 program, and definitely recommend that to everyone. But like, yeah, we can discuss more about the learnings from that program as we go through the session today. And exciting to be here and to answer any questions you guys might have just around my experiences. Thank you.
So first, again, congratulations, that's awesome. So I'm Eyal Amir, I'm a co-founder and CEO of ParkNav. What ParkNav does is it tells drivers in real time if parking is available in the street. We now cover every street in 240 cities between the US and Europe. We're gonna be in all BMW cars sold in US and Germany starting November. I was an SOP 2013 in Chicago, and since I moved here about kind of the end of 2013, I've been active with the SOP groups here and in San Francisco, and I love the synergy and I love the support and all of the help that you guys have given. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Sweta, and I have a little bit of a different background, I think, more on the consumer side. So I'm a relatively new grad. I graduated from Stanford in 2012, and I studied mathematical computational science. When I graduated, I worked at Facebook for a couple years as a data scientist, and my passion has always been sports. So while I was at Stanford, I noticed that there are kids that came from all over all the different parts of the country, a lot of the major metropolitan cities like Los Angeles, New York, Boston, Chicago. But there wasn't really an easy way for us to interact with each other, discover each other, or have fun conversations while games are going on. So when I graduated from Stanford and worked at Facebook as a data scientist, I did a hack project where I identified the different markets of fans, And what I discovered was over half of all socially engaged fans in the U.S. live outside the state of their favorite team. So for me, I'm a really big San Antonio Spurs fan. I don't know how many of you follow basketball. I guess with the Warriors doing well, maybe it's everyone. Show of hands. You're a Spurs fan. That's good. So I've really developed the engine for these fans to create this community and allow them to discover each other. And that's been my story. Right now, we have an app available on Google Play and the App Store. We're more in the early stages of the product and getting feedback from our fans. It's been an interesting experience from the growth perspective for a consumer business.
Hi, my name is Ashwin Gunashekar. I'm the founder and CEO of Zetto. Zetto is transforming the way EEG is done in hospitals. EEG, or electroencephalography, is measuring your brain waves, similar to ECG, but for the brain. And it's still very archaic, and it takes a lot of time and puts the patient through a very poor experience. We're transforming that with a headset-like device, cloud-like platform. My background, I was an electrical engineer for about 10 years, doing chip design at AMD and Intel. Then I got my MBA at the University of Texas at Austin. That's when the idea was formed, and I went into management consulting for a bit, but the idea always kept, knocking back, as to like the opportunity was still there, and I kept validating it for about 2 years, and finally I started the company. We raised about $1 million right now, and we're full on with product development.
Hello, everyone. My name is J.R. Alawi. I'm founder and CEO of Iris. I'd like to thank you, Ashish and Satish, for the invitation. So we're a deep learning-based face analytics and emotion recognition based on facial micro-expression technology. We go after two verticals, driver monitoring, as well as social robotics. I guess that's pretty much it. I'll keep it short.
Thank you. You can keep that, okay. So we can share. By the way, it was not intended. That's the SLP side, and this is the non-SLP side. It just happened to sit like that. It was not pre-planned, I assure you. But so coming back to the theme for today, start wise, stay wise. So I want to focus on the start wise. We know they are entrepreneurs. They obviously have jumped. But I want to explore looking at when somebody starts to say, okay, I'm going to jump in or I'm going to do something. And you alluded, some of you, to that, but I want to explore that a bit, which is, you can have a personal passion or you can have domain expertise, so you're kind of tuned in to the opportunity where you can detect the opportunity. Maybe you're working in a big company and you see something and your domain expertise takes you closer to seeing that opportunity. Or you have, through, again, your network or through other ways, you have insight into the market and the customer pain points. Or you just stumbled on and you said, I'm just going to just go do it and I'll figure it out, and you pivoted. So can you speak on your paths, your journey of starting out and finding this opportunity, or in the past, other opportunities that you've dealt with? And let's start with JR first.
Since I was the shortest one, obviously. So this is my third startup. I'm going to talk about my second one, since it's been a long time since my first and second one. I started a company in 2008 that does, it was the first US FTC compliance face recognition measured in-store TV network. It's like a long description, a long name for a bunch of TV displays in airports and shopping malls that have a camera, and the camera was connected to a computer. And then obviously the computer had a face recognition software. And so we were licensing content from E! News and Fashion TV and Reuters and all of the content providers, running a private TV network in the malls and the shopping centers and the airports. And then we would plug in video commercials for 30-second and 50-second ads that are targeting people based on gender and age group. So as you were to walk down the hallway at an airport, within 10 feet away, the camera recognizes you by gender or age group, and both. And then it, within probably 5-6 feet away, it broadcast an advertising message that is geared towards your age group. So if you were a female, it would say L'Oreal commercial. If you're a male, it would say something else. And that was quite ambitious, but we found ourselves at a intersection of hardware, software, retail, advertising. And it was just, not at the best time for advertising in this country. If you guys remember, 2008 was really not a good time for a startup in general. What led me to this is, we did okay. We did actually quite good considering at the time, 2011, we launched a small R&D project to extract more features from the face as opposed to just age and gender and people counts and things like that. We achieved very good results. We then decided to, started using deep learning back before deep learning was a thing, and probably before even the term was coined. We had to collect our own data sets. We collected millions of images and videos, annotate them manually with a team, feed them into the algorithm. It was a daunting task. It took us quite a while to get an algorithm to where it is today. 2013, we pivoted. This led me to my third startup, which is this one now, into a software-only company. We lead the space for face analytics, and we, even with that, and I'm sure you're gonna, have some questions about what the pitfalls are and what are the challenges and things like that. Even with that, there were some challenges. It's like what I like to call the idea maze. You keep navigating through a lot of challenges until you find a pretty wide path that where you can feel comfortable along with the company. And so I guess that is for us now is embedded systems as a big umbrella. Low-hanging fruits are automotive and social robotics, just because of the amount of traction there is there today. It's pretty exciting time, I guess.
So one thing you mentioned is timing, right? Timing and the approach of whether it's not just hardware, software, and everything, but focusing on software only, finding the right size and the right, where the friction is least, and find the right timing, I guess, if I can say, a very important aspect of finding success, or at least traction.
Definitely. So it's not the timing of the technology, and just to kind of clarify, it's the timing of the market acceptance of the technology as well. A lot of great technologies were created a long, long time. Deep learning dates back to 2 decades ago, but obviously the market wasn't ready for it. The hardware wasn't there, the data collection wasn't there, a lot of things weren't there. So the ideal scenario is that you'd start a company just a year or two before you would think the market would accept it at a exponential rate. Obviously, if you want to grow a big company. And obviously, it's a difficult formula. You can't always know what it is and what that timing is and what that technology may be. But I like to, say sometimes you want to be a pattern recognizer as opposed to somebody who just predicts out of nowhere.
Awesome. Awesome insight. And let me move on to Ashwin. I think you mentioned that you did due diligence of your own research for a couple of years. I mean, that's pretty intense analysis.
Well, my product was such, right? It's opposed to something, offering something for a customer that they don't know yet. Mine is a product that is a medical device, and we are bringing a process improvement and not an outcome change. So as a result, you can validate the heck out of the market. You go to the customer, you talk, you position, you pivot, and then you figure out what exactly you need to build. The real question is, if you build it, will they come? And what I was trying to answer for 18 months is, if I build it, they will come. And I actually took 2 years. As part of my 6 months in the business school, it was a new venture class, and it started with figuring out a problem that we had domain expertise in and building a serious product for a serious need. So that was our two main criteria. So we started off with that, and we came to, and the brainstorming was, hey, what kind of problems can we solve? And it came to my cousin having epilepsy, and why can't we do something about it, right? So I'm going to kind of take you quickly through my story there. We started off as a device that would predict seizures for him, as a headset that would predict seizures. And I didn't build anything, nothing until about like 7 months after I started the company, because at that point I already pivoted into an EEG device, which is much larger because doctors and patients said they wanted that more than just a seizure monitoring device. So that's my story. My main thing is, don't build anything until you're really sure about the validation of the opportunity. That's what you need to do first. And if it's a visionary product, more power to you. I don't have many comments on that.
Awesome. Again, just to reiterate, know what to build before you actually go spend too much time building. Really know your customer, know the positioning, find the fit. So I think as starting out, I like to believe that you've got to think like a product manager combined with something else. But that's the core skill to have, to really have tune in the market and go out there and actually talk to customers that you will see as a common pattern. Your story, though, is a little different. Your story is driven from your own passion, and you also felt a personal need, which then you mapped into a bigger need. Can you comment on that?
Yeah, I think the challenge there is you have to be able to understand whether your personal pain point is large enough to build a business around it. And so I was able to use my data background to figure out that information. So I got a sense for, I did a lot of market research before starting the company and securing the funding. A lot of the research was really understanding what fans were currently using for some of these sports conversations, understanding the fan-to-fan dynamics, understanding why existing platforms wouldn't solve this need, and figuring out what the product that we needed to build was. And along the way, I got some good validation. So in 2014, we were invited to participate in a startup contest at the MIT Sloan Sports Analytics Conference, which is like the biggest sports conference, I guess, in the world, because I don't know how many analytics features conferences there are outside the US, but they say it's the biggest one in the world. And I got to pitch the concept before we even had a product to well-known VCs. One of them was Bill Gurley, who is one of the lead investors in Uber and from Benchmark and a bunch of other well-known startups in the social space and also other areas. And we ended up winning that. So that was good validation from the standpoint of the investors and people identifying the need. I think the biggest challenge when I came up with the idea was making sure that the product that we were building really addressed the pain point. And that's something that we're continuing to iterate on. So we have an MVP out that has the major three professional sports leagues, so NFL, NBA, and MLB. And one of the challenges right now is understanding the seasonality. So that's kind of the place that we are in the product cycle, to see the patterns of behavior. And because my background, I'm a really big NBA fan, but we wanted to build the product so that it would work for people that liked multiple sports. And right now, one thing that we're definitely learning is for baseball, there's just way too many games. And the most popular feature of our product was games for NBA, especially during the playoffs when there's fewer of them. So learning those dynamic market conditions and being able to iterate on them quickly, I think, is pretty key once you have a product out in the market. And also having a great way to get feedback from your initial user base and understanding whether the current people that are using your product are actually the right people that you want to market to, who are going to help scale it. So those are some of the challenges that are probably more specific to the consumer space, but it's really interesting. As you segment a market, you also have to understand the intent of that market. And I think that's been one of the most exciting and challenging parts of founding Fanbana.
Great, great insight. So again, outside-in perspective and a good read on the market and analysis in some way or the other, in your case with data. And this key thing I want to just emphasize here, it may be that you feel a personal pain, or maybe you're very passionate about something, but is there a market for it? That's the first question. Is there a big enough market for it? And third question, can you reach that market? It may be that there's a nice market there, but you have no way to reach it, whether through channels, routes, and so on. And I'll explore that on that side, because each of you, in some sense, it's not consumer, you're dependent. In your case also, you depend on pathways into the market. So if you can maybe also emphasize, because in your case, I think you have a big partnership that you're pursuing, so if you can talk about that.
Cool. So I wish I had done what Sweta was describing about market research. I did, I think, all the mistakes in the book. I started fully employed, started doing things in my spare time, coming up with the idea of how technologically predicting parking availability could work. And I was sure that we would just create an app and all of the users would use it and they will even pay. And they told me, you know, I actually went to, you know, a couple of people in the coffee place and they said, sure, I'll give you $12 per month for this kind of thing. And I said, great, I did my market research. And it didn't work that way, unfortunately. And we ended up doing those kinds of learning by making errors like three or four times. We did four pivots. It's the same technology, same concept, just different product, different market. And we ended up now what we do is we're a B2B company. We license the data to automotive, to real estate, to cities, to mobile payment, really a bunch of sectors. But really what saved me, I think, you know, it's been now... So I'm like the poster boy for how not to do it, because really it's been 6 years. I started in December 2009. It's been 6 years. Three of them I worked as a professor in a university, and so I had a full-time job, and I would do this part-time, and so my co-founder would do the same. And then... Along the way, we had some successes, but until 2013, I didn't really decide to leave. We had an opportunity. I left, burned all of my money, including the credit cards, needed to almost beg for money in the streets of Palo Alto. Fortunately, it didn't happen. But it was really a lot of ups and downs on the way for this. So the first investment that we got was... 2 years ago, 2.5 years ago, and that was like 70K from, you know, it's a known company, but it's a child company of Deutsche Telekom. But, you know, for us, $70,000, I mean, it's nothing. And at the same time, it was like, oh my God, somebody's investing in us. So so we took it, even though it was draconian terms. And then a year later, fortunately for us, the market became ready. The market in this case is the automotive industry. They became ready after doing 3 years earlier, they did a POC with us. Then they were ready, and by chance somebody remembered that we actually have this kind of thing because they always go to their natural suppliers who have all the sales connections. So somebody remembered and they kind of called us out of the blue, and I thought that this was like a hoax because they sent me an email saying, please sign this NDA. It's like, do I know you? What do you mean? Sign this NDA. And I asked to talk to the purchasing officer, and he said, look, I cannot really tell you, but, you know, we're real. You know, sign this NDA, and then I can tell you. Okay, and then everything started flying from there.
Great. So the insight there, if I may just summarize, which is stick with it. And in this case, maybe do some a little bit more research. But I think the more important thing there is to figure out as you're going, and the notion of fail fast. I mean, get good at recognizing when some market is telling you this is not the product or not the right time or not the right shape or size. And then the other is perseverance, right? You have to just believe in it enough. So it's a delicate balance. And certainly, I think that's the some of the patterns that you have to have as an entrepreneur, skills, if you will, non-technical, but this ability to read the market and timing and all of those things. And then domain expertise also matters a lot. And so Shiv, if you can maybe speak from that angle and your own experience.
Sure. Yeah, so when I joined the SLP program, that was in 2012, and I didn't know, right, like what's the kind of the participants, the cohort will be. And one thing I realized was that it was mostly around B2C, right, and the domain in which I or an area in which I have no experience, right? It was a good 6 months because the different aspects of starting a company, building your network and all that you get exposed to, which is invaluable, right? So that was not, B2C was not the general space in which I and my co-founder started the company, we went back to our domain, right? We went back to our comfort zone. So I think that's very important, at least for me, that especially in enterprise space, if you have spent 10, 15 years of your career working in hardcore computer science technologies, you really, have a lot of domain expertise. And if you have been in companies where, or startups or large companies where you have built products which have, which consumers, customers or enterprises have used, now you have access to a good set of potential customers for you. It's not hard to get into, it's not easy to get into enterprises, right? There's a lot of, hierarchies there. It's not like you put an app out there and people will use it, right? You really have to get into the right people in the right departments, whether it's IT, whether it's marketing, and they need to listen to you, they need to give you time, and then they have 100 other priorities and all that, right? And they need to have a budget for it and all that. So because we were, or I and my co-founders have been in this domain of data centers and networking and security, it was a very natural thing to kind of see where that's kind of it's heading next and what could be a potential valuable thing to build. And some of that things you learn in your past life as you, build out products and engage with your customers. But one of the main thing that I'll say is that, especially in enterprise, because I've not built a consumer product or a consumer company, in enterprise, it's very important that you have that initial set of customers who are kind of your design partners with you, who will test that alpha product, right? You don't need a lot of enterprise customers. If you have large enterprise customers, which is if that's your target market, if you have 5, 7, 8 of those to work with you closely in building out that first version, that alpha product or beta, depending on what stage you are in, and that's good enough, right? So for us, it has been understanding the domain so that you feel comfortable, right? And especially when you approach VCs for money, right? They have a standard checklist, and you need to get checks on a few things. So do these guys know what they're talking about, right? Do these guys have a team that or expertise that they can build something in this space? So those are some checks which you want to quickly get, because there are a lot of things that you need to anyhow convince them or prove to them, which is how large this market can be, how will you go to market, how will you price this product, how will you find customers, and all that, right? So you need to get certain checks. So I would encourage, that has been my journey, to leverage your experience, your domain knowledge that you have. People do start companies where it's completely orthogonal. And again, when I joined the SLP program for 6 months, when I was part of it, I was exploring with a few of my colleagues, B2C startup. But again, at the end of it, it was very obvious that it's very hard to kind of do it if you don't have that kind of understanding. So,
great. I think the key insight that I want to just echo here is that, again, you may think you have a good idea, but you really have to understand how it's going to be consumed or sold or bought by the customer. You really have to be able to get close to them for early validation and have domain expertise to understand and be able to have credibility in front of both customers and investors. And if you don't have that, part of your evaluation of should I pursue this, A or B, you got to factor those in, not just the fact that you have a cool idea, you can outsource it or build it yourself and just launch it and they'll come. That may not happen. And Ilker, in your case, you kind of went from in some sense, enterprise to consumer.
Absolutely. That's an interesting journey. And it's in progress. So obviously, I spend a lot of time at Cisco Enterprise B2B. That's been my expertise. And when we had this idea of a startup, many ideas, that the one that we've chosen in Internet of Things security, which is a big deal because we are talking about potentially 50 billion devices that are connected to the internet in about like 5 years. To put that into perspective, there are only 7 billion people on this planet. So we are talking about like 7 times the number of people that will exist and things that are connected to the internet. And we were fascinated by this problem. We wanted to solve that. And given our background, we came up with a lot of potential problem statements and solutions to that, because the problem space in IoT is huge. So you can really find a lot of different things. But the one that tempted us the most, really the use case was in the B2C scenario. And how did we know this? Because in this room, I took a course from Raj Joshua. It was a very interesting course. And there was a business class competition, which we ended up winning. And the way that we won it, so I presented the pitch that was obviously successful, so we won that. But the feedback, the people that came to us and asked the questions, they were always going to their individual use cases. They were describing perfect problems for us. One of them was actually Ashish in a later scenario. And I was impressed because every time that I'm hearing these things, and he mentioned something about picking patterns, the patterns were obvious. There was an unaddressed problem in the IoT space that was top of the mind for people, which we knew that we could solve because our solution could solve this. The big decision was, should we go in this space? Because I've spent my entire career in B2B. Now, talking about building a solution in B2C, which is a risky venture in some ways, but personally, I'm a problem solver. And if I am convinced that there is a problem that exists, and if I have a good bet in solving that, I will go for it. And B2C, so you need to acknowledge your risks, the risks that you are taking. We are taking a market risk. That was the most obvious thing, and we had to accept that. And I took it to my co-founder, and we discussed that and said, yes, this is something that we can take because the problem is very real, the solution is very real, we know that we can make a dent in this, so let's go for this. One thing I want to say, which is kind of mentioned here, but if you follow the pattern, if you attend these kind of events and if you talk to people like this on this panel, like us, one thing that will be very obvious, 99% of the scenarios, people don't end up with the ideas or the actual idea that they start with. It always morphs. So how many times have you already talked about pivots here? The timelines, the timing was wrong, the product was not the right one, switching from B2B, B2C. One thing we did not mention is about people. It's about people. Startups are about people. They are not about ideas. Ideas come and go. I've pursued personally at least 5 or 6 ideas as fun and all the others, and I built products. One of the products that I built as a prototype, a similar one, actually the exact one, got acquired by Walmart. Another one that I decided not to pursue in the security space made it to the Gartner's list as one of the top promising technologies. And two of them, I'm still convinced that they're not the best ideas, but doesn't matter. It's about the people. If you have the right people, you will have the versatility to make the right decisions at the right time. If the timing is not right, if you need to change your technology, if you need to change your product, that's the people. It's not the ideas, it's not the technology. You can rewrite the technology if you have the right team. So invest in people. If you are doing a startup, if you are thinking of doing a startup, your biggest investment is the team that you are bringing together, starting with your co-founder. That's extremely important. And that's the case. My co-founder and I sat down and we think that this is the area to make a difference. We know we can make a difference. In 4 months, we already have a working product, more than a minimum viable product, more than an MVP that's working in 15 different places, getting great feedback. So we are making progress and great progress and seeing how to take it to market. But I wouldn't be surprised if we will get other things and we will need to steer our direction, adjust, course correct. But I'm confident about my team and our ability to execute. I bet on people more than ideas.
Great. And that's very, very key. I think we'll explore that in terms of how not only two themes there. One is the co-founder, having a co-founder or not. And then after this, we will open up for some questions from the audience. Elaborate on that. You talked about having a co-founder, and this is open to anybody, any order, just to mix it up. But how valuable has it been to have a co-founder? It can work both ways. You can have disputes and you can have differences. And then this common alignment, how do you achieve that with your co-founder?
Not easy. I mean, you might have heard this. Finding a co-founder is like marrying someone. It's really, I don't think it's that different. I'm not, so it's challenging, but in my mind, a co-founder is absolutely necessary. It's a complementary skill set. From that perspective, it's necessary. Not only that, but there is so much you need to do that in a startup that you don't have enough mental and physical energy and time. You really need someone that you can rely on. How do you find a co-founder? There are many ways, I guess, but it's so key that you find the right co-founder, and several SLP classes are dedicated to this. At least one is dedicated to that, which I think is a very valuable class. You need to find the people that preferably you've worked with and you understand your dynamics. And if you have not, you need to find a way to create that dynamic, meaning you need to give some time to work that with that person or people and then make sure that you can work. It's so key. Preferably, I was lucky. My co-founder is a former colleague of mine from Cisco, also a very good friend of mine that I worked with for 7 years, so we know how to work with each other. We build a lot of products together. We are friends. I know his family. It helps because we know each other. It's not always rosy. We were discussing something this morning, so I have my opinions. He has his opinions. Everything just differs. That's normal. But we know how to address that. It's very important that you get along. You know how to address your challenges, and you define your roles and responsibilities clearly. So those are the key things. There is no silver bullet, but having a co-founder for me is absolutely necessary. I don't think this is something that you can do by yourself. You'll exhaust yourself. It might be doable. There are cases, obviously, but I think it's so much more difficult. It's exponentially more difficult to do it by yourself without having a co-founder or multiple co-founders.
Great. Very important. But Shiv, in your case, it's not just two. It's actually more. So how do you deal with that?
Yeah, so for enterprise software, I'll strongly advise never do a company by yourself, right? I mean, you have to have co-founders. So I never had to find a co-founder, right? Me and, so there are three of us, but specifically two of us, we have known each other for 20 years, right? So like you said, right, it's almost like, it seems like a process of getting married kind of thing. We went to school together. We have worked together in several companies. It's one of the most important thing, if not the most important thing. It's critical that there is no second guessing going on between you and your co-founder. It's almost like when we went to raise money and we raised a total of $20 million, when we raised money, I mean, our VC would give us the feedback that if I'm starting a sentence, he's finishing it, right? It has to be like that. There are so many other things to take care of in a startup. The last thing that should be on your mind is that the trust between you and your co-founder, right? So there's nothing better than picking someone with whom you have a long working relationship. And working is important, you know, I mean, if it's just a friend, then you guys may see the professional side of each other for the first time, right? Which may or may not like. So I think it's important that you have a working relationship, a past, like you've worked together or and not you're not just friends, right? If you're friends, great. So there were three of us who started this. And again, as I said, all had domain experience. So when you go to a VC to raise money, there are certain checks you want to quickly get through. Is the team there? Can it execute? Does it have the expertise? You don't want to fight that battle to begin with, right? And we shared equity, right? So I think we started on a very clean, positive slate, and then things worked out.
Great. And the key pattern, if I may paraphrase, knew each other really well, had common levels of domain expertise, truly aligned around the vision and the problem that you're trying to solve. Plus also, I think there was very clear role demarcation where you could trust that person to run that role. So it's not just about being friends and say, okay, let's just go do a startup, but understanding how you would execute the business and take responsibility for your parts and then be truly aligned. The long history of association really helped in that case. So more is not necessarily bad. You just have to make sure it's very well defined as to what the expectations are.
So in my case, so I have one co-founder and two partners, and I'll explain how that goes. But I'll say first that I started by myself. I tried to find a co-founder, couldn't find anybody that would be the right fit. And then my first advisor said to me, look, man, you need to stop trying to recruit your co-founder and start doing. And it was a great advice. I started doing, and once I created something, you know, half a year later, and a few parties that celebrated small advances, I had a concept. I had a proof of concept. This thing actually works, and then I was able to find my co-founder. So we advanced. Maybe a year and a half later, after we had the first money from our first POC, we recruited our first recruit became our partner when the money ran out. And also because he actually brought something to the team that, you know, until very recently, let's say 2 years ago, I didn't really completely appreciate it. And that's the ability to sell but ability to sell in the sense of enterprise sales and that are long cycle. This is a very different beast than anything that I'm a technologist in my background. My co-founder is a technologist. You know, it's not about smiling. It's not about saying, yes, this is really great. It's a very, very different sale when you can make 100 mistakes in one sale. So, and the fourth partner joined when his startup collapsed, and it was a great opportunity to recruit him. And we all have, obviously, completion of things, completion of capabilities. Because of the way that it advanced, different people in this partnership have different equity, have different responsibility, have different power. But then it's a different challenge. You need to make sure that you're not forcing anybody, because if any one of them decides that I'm not happy, that's going to create a shock that can kill the company. So it's a game. Not all of the personalities fit. Not all of the, not everybody is happy with each other. Still, it's not that they don't respect each other. Sometimes they think, oh, this guy's an idiot. But, it comes from a lot of our egos. Each one of the four of us has a very big ego. So, you know, we all need to work on essentially doing a little bit of group therapies once in a while. And it's just part of the process. It's part of the process of building a company.
Great. And Sweta, in your experience?
Yeah, so I have a pretty unusual experience, I guess. So I grew up in the Silicon Valley, and my dad is a serial entrepreneur himself. So he actually is my co-founder, which is pretty unusual. And his background is very much in enterprise. So that's actually what has been very helpful for us in some of the cloud scaling aspects and the technology part of our infrastructure that supports the consumer. So I think early on, someone said about mixing and matching between consumer and enterprise, and I actually think there's a lot of value there. My background has been in consumer. I obviously have a lot less experience than my father, but it's very different experience. And I think when we came together, I brought a lot of the product, the passion, the personal pain point, as well as the overall vision for the company. And from his perspective, a lot of it was the back-end technologies, and then the experience of starting a company before. And I think that's something that I was really fortunate to have through all the stages of our company and the product. So the first stage, I think, is preparing the business plan and making sure that your concept makes sense. That's like step zero. And then raising the capital, I had no experience with that. So it was great to get that help as well. And then in terms of building a scalable product, I had experience with that, but in a very different scale and with very different resources. So I think that I really benefited from that. And then the team that we built is also very varied experience, working across different products and different technologies. So I think if you can get a team together that's really passionate about a particular idea but has a different set of skills, you can build something really interesting. And there's some initial pain points with getting the team together and making sure you gel. But once you are able to work together on products and projects, I think that chemistry starts to build. And now we have a pretty solid product team as well as overall camaraderie. So I think it's been a really interesting and different experience.
Yeah, it is. And I think the key thing there is the complementary skills part, which is doesn't matter what the context of the partnership is, but they are bringing something to the table that you don't have yourself. So you're assembling a bigger whole. 2 + 2 becomes more than 4. I think that's key to assemble teams, because that's all the fuel. All the assets that you have is yourself and your team starting out. So you got to really deploy it in the best way possible. And I think that chemistry is also extremely important. Make sure that you're not losing capacity in dealing with You have to have group therapy, as he said, or you have to have long-term alignment and long-term relationships and ways of dealing with ways of maintaining synergies. But I think that's very important. Aswin, in your case, I don't know if it's similar or not.
I'm the only founder. The answer really is it depends. It depends on what you're doing and who you're doing it for. I would strictly advise against meeting a stranger, courting him for 1 week and shaking his hand and bringing him on as co-founder just to fill up that co-founder role, because it can really wreck the ship. You really need to know the person. And if it happens by that way, as Shiv and the last person out there, he said, that's great. But don't get into a relationship. This is huge. This can be mentally very stressful. To answer the question whether it depends, look at your product, look at who you're building it for. Your earliest milestone, if you don't have a co-founder, right? If you have a co-founder, you know the person, all power to you, move on. But if you don't, these are the questions you need to ask. What are the upcoming milestones in the next 6 to 12 months? Is it building an MVP? Is it raising money, right? These are the two big milestones, and probably, you know, building the core team to build the product. You better have that core team, because that's integral to you starting the business in the first place. If you think you can both build a product, be a good product manager, and raise the money as well, go on, keep moving. Don't go start hunting for a co-founder just because someone said so. Keep moving, because things will fall in place. Right now, my situation is I have a lead engineer, I have a neuroscientist, and I have someone who's filling in that co-founder role as an advisor. He's a serial entrepreneur, and he's filling in that role very effectively for me. He's a sounding board, he attends meetings with me, and he advises me on all those critical situations where you would not have the complete perspective. So, to summarize, it depends.
Well said. I think the key insight I want to reiterate there is to assemble from your network the right expertise in any shape or form it is, but you got to have access to the expertise. And it's your responsibility to recognize what you don't have and go get it so you can complement those skills. Because I think what you said, the early stage of the startup is almost one step away from death. So you got to figure out what do you need to do to execute on to go to the next step, and who do you need to actually make that happen. So I think that's very, very valuable insight. JR, from your perspective, I guess two or three pivots or startups.
Yeah, I think everything is being said. In our case, Satish over there has definitely helped, put the company on the map in the very early stages. But it all depends, it's down to, who complements who with what, right? If you can write code and you have excellent business skills, great. If you really lack one of these two, you really have to look at somebody else who you can trust, and not just to fill in the role of a co-founder, but to fill in the role of somebody that you can build a long-lasting company with. And yes, it is just like marriage, and yes, it is, tough and ups and downs and all of that good stuff. If you were to ask me, as an investor, most companies that come to VCs that say, our preference is two co-founders. We sometimes, two to three, we're reluctant about four, and we're reluctant about one. And obviously these are cases that are, on a case by case basis, but you'd see the majority is two or three, at least here in the Valley for a reason. And for, it's for the same reasons that everybody here, talked about on the panel.
Great. We'll come back and I'll ask some more questions, but let's open up questions from the audience. I'm sure you are dying to ask your favorite question. I have a mic here, which we can circulate. I cannot step too far out, I'm told, otherwise there'll be a kind of feedback, so please circulate. We'll take a few questions. Feel free to ask.
Hi, this question is for Tamir. So Cisco is big on IoT. And a couple of years ago, a Cisco vice president gave a speech or presentation in Singapore about the big opportunities IoT is going to bring out. So what are some of, this is for the benefit of the entire audience, what are some of the areas where a startup can reap the benefits of IoT? In other words, if you were not to be in IoT security, what other areas would you be in? Thank you.
Thank you. So Cisco is a great company, right? So there's a reason why I spent 15 years
It's very active in a lot of areas. IoT is one of them, security is another. The reason I wanted to do my own thing was really personal passion. I just wanted to be nimble, quick, and I want to create things, and I want to create that from the fundamental building block. My job at Cisco was still creating stuff, but the scale is different, but also where you start is different. And there are ways that you succeed in Cisco versus in a startup. There are the approaches, like when I was owning products, our competitive strategy that I developed against startups was different. And now if I need to compete, I will draft a very fundamentally different competitive strategy. Switching back, if I didn't do IoT, what would I do? I would pick a niche and try to come up with a solution that is definitely the category, the best in class in that niche. That's what I would do. In security, I would pick one of the unsolved problems. So if you're talking about security, this might be a little too specific for the audience. I just don't necessarily want to go to the specifics. But in security, there are two dynamics. There are verticals. There are unsolved problems. One is spear phishing, if you know the term. I send you an email that seems to be coming your friend or Ashish or someone else that you know. You open the email and things go highway. There are solutions. FireEye has a solution. Cisco has a solution. But fundamentally, it's an unsolved problem. That's most of the sophisticated attacks start that way. As an example, I had an idea on how to solve that problem or do something about that area. So that could be an area. How I would approach this is really one of the two things. If you are competing in an area where that's highly crowded, you need to find a niche and solve that niche in a way that no one else can solve, but make sure that that has adjacent growth areas. So once you solve that niche, you are not stuck in that niche, but you can then take it and put the next areas. Peter Thiel has a great book on that one and explaining how the methodology works. That's what I would do. This is one example. I can come up with a lot more examples in security and elsewhere, but this would be my methodology.
Thank you.
Great. Question here.
Great panel. Question for almost anyone here. Essentially, anybody who's starting a company thinks about recruiting engineers, and especially in the Valley where you have competition from Facebook, Google, and all the biggies out there throwing money. What can entrepreneurs like yourself, what worked for you guys in recruiting developers?
One of the best ways to find people, in my experience, is events like this. Because people who come here are, by definition, passionate about something. All the people who wanted to move with me, except for my co-founder, I found either in Thai, one at a startup weekend, and actually two at a startup weekend, two different startup weekends, all startup events, because the like-minded people go there, and when they work with you, that's an opportunity where you can work with people outside of work. And they work with you, and they get passionate about your ideas, your personality, a lot of things, and that's the best way. Because if you go into the game of paying and like the salary, if you go into the salary game, you can't beat Google's and Facebook's and in some ways just all the other players. That's not the right way. The way to impress them is starting with passion, and you need to find like-minded people to start with. That's my experience.
Anybody else? You don't have to all speak, but anybody has a burning...
No, I just want to say that for the first few people, your core team, you cannot go and hire through a recruiter, right? And the best is your network, either people from your college, people from whom you have worked in the with whom you have worked in the past. There is nothing better than that, and they need to join because, again, they like you as a person. They like the area that you are working. When they are passionate about doing a startup, right, themselves at some point, and at this point they are ready to kind of be part of an early stage startup. And you have to share equity with them. You have to give them, I would say, market rate. Market rate doesn't mean that all the perks and everything that large company gives, but salary level, I think, is still... So if you have not raised money, it's challenging in that case. The guy has to be really driven and either case, you should not be tight-fisted about equity, right? It's very important to share equity. In fact, we had a big team in India, 20-people team in India. We treated them like they're US employees in terms of equity.
Any other?
My experience was, firstly, there is no set way, right? I'll give you just a couple of insight into how hiring went for us. It's always one step at a time. I found the first person who was super passionate, who wanted to solve this problem as well because he was in the medical community. And then once we started talking to him, he said, hey, these guys have built this system in this university. So I called them up and I spoke to them, and who built this for you? And then came the engineers, right? So, and after those engineers came on board, those engineers were recommending, hey, there's this really cool person. He's all over the forums and his insight is so good, right? So I went after him and then I brought him onto the team. So this is how it grows. And you know, it's not like you're not throwing a wide net out there like a corporate, an Apple or a Facebook does. You're really going after, you know, where this person is, and you have to be a really good founder to sniff that out. You have to keep your eyes open all the time. There's only two things you do as a founder: people and strategy. People is the essential part.
Fiddle, you add your insights?
Yeah, I think you really have to inspire people with the problem and the solution that you have. So I agree with, I think, what he said. I think it's challenging, obviously, to hire people that you don't know or strangers, especially because there's no emotional connection. So I think that's really key, especially when, late at night when you're having coding session or bug squash sessions. It's really hard to get someone who you just hired to come on board, who you don't have any kind of relationship with, or who doesn't fundamentally believe in what you're building to work with you. So I think that's really important.
Well said, well said. Another question, we can give the mic, please. Pass on the mic.
Thank you, great panel. So I have kind of more specific maybe. So let's say if you're starting a retail application or a social media kind of application, how do you get it validated? Or how do you go about, you know, let's say you have a certain prototype, and then how do you make sure it is in the right direction or not? Any thoughts on that?
Is this for any one person?
Yeah, anyone.
Anyone?
Anyone.
Okay. Anybody have a...
I mean, I guess you should probably first think about pain points that you have as an individual. That's usually the easiest way to start, and then the next step is kind of understanding, are you representative of a large enough denominator that it makes sense to build this product? Or you have to understand, why does such a product not yet exist? Is it just that your idea is so great, or have people tried before and did it not make sense? I think a lot of it is market research, looking at what's already out there for that space, and also understanding exactly what the need is and how you're planning to solve it. I think that is the case for everything. It's not just consumer. I mean, I think that's a fundamental aspect of coming up with a concept that you're going to spend probably years working on. So you want to do as much homework as you can before then. Okay. It's really hard to change, I think, after you've committed to a concept.
The question, let's quickly ask here and then we'll go over there.
My question is to Ashwin, what type of problem exactly you like to solve? Being a doctor, I like to know personally.
I'm sorry, can you repeat the question?
Your startup, exactly what problem you like to solve for the patients?
Oh, what are we solving?
Yeah.
Okay. EEG currently, it's a very archaic procedure. Acquiring EEG in the hospital is a very archaic procedure. It takes about 2 hours just to get a half hour recording. You have to scratch the surface of the skin, apply gel, all that stuff. And if you look at the entire value chain of the EEG, acquisition is not, and it requires technicians also. Acquisition is broken, and then sharing of the data is also broken between the doctors. Once EEG is acquired, you can share the data. And then third is interpretation. Who's gonna read the EEG? If you don't have a neurologist on call in that particular facility, you can't read the EEG. So the whole value chain is broken. And our product is a wearable headset that makes acquisition of EEG less than a minute. You just don the headset, you're acquiring EEG, directly goes to the cloud. And on the cloud is, on the platform, you can pick the neurologist you want to be interpreted by. So now any hospital can avail the service. So that's the model.
Have you done the pricing?
Sorry?
Pricing?
We are also disrupting the pricing way because we're not selling it as a classical medical device. We're going as a paper test model. So give the device for free and charge per test.
Is it available anywhere outside US now?
Not yet. It needs to be FDA approved in the US, and the US market is our target market.
Thank you.
Thank you. One question over there. If you can just quickly pass the mic. And while we are doing that, just want to emphasize a couple of things, right? you really, I mean, this is an example. Two people, what they said, really know the market like the back of your hand or palm, and really know exactly what pain point you're solving, where the problems are, and where you are adding value. I think that intimacy of understanding how the customer is utilizing and where the pain points are, it's crucial to have a sustainable advantage.
Eyal, I think you had mentioned receiving some draconian terms. I'm curious how many of you before doing a bigger round did, you know, did you do convertible debt? Did you do friends and family with convertible debt? And then also, yeah, what your recommendations are in terms of, because you hear all the time about how startups end up getting sometimes some tough terms, or they, you know, give away the house too early, things like that. So just sort of recommendations on the equity front in terms of fundraising and if you guys did do convertible debt.
So I'll just comment a little bit. We, you know, on the one hand, draconian terms are part of doing business. You know, if you can negotiate, it's totally negotiation. There is no such thing, in my opinion, there is no such thing as price. It's really about negotiation power and the way that you can get into some terms and not others. In our case, by the way, there is a mix of equity and convertible notes. Convertible notes are actually the most recent. And they, in general, so we haven't yet raised any institutional round. And the money, because of that, is a little bit more prone to error, meaning the investors don't always have the experience of what would happen later down the line and are more informed by television. So, I mean, of course, these are not dumb people at all. I'm just saying that sometimes they put terms that would hurt you, and they just don't really see it right now. And they would hurt, therefore, their investment. But they don't see it yet. And so it is a little bit up to you as an entrepreneur to be educated and also just open it to the conversation. Tell them, look, if this is what's going to be, if this is, you know, let's say that I agree to this, look at what will happen in a year or two. Okay, and so, because at that time, you're again on their side. So it is, the bottom line, it's all negotiation and conversation.
I would agree, convertible debt is the right way to do it, especially for a seed stage company. I think the key point is your lead investor. That person is very important because he sets the term. And then you can always say, hey, lead investor so-and-so who knows this has already come in. Because everybody is looking at, has anyone else put in money? That's the thing. And investors are like a herd, right? They're looking at who's going in first, and then they typically follow. That's the truth. I mean, however savvy they say they are, the majority of them are like a herd. So focus on getting the right person as the lead investor. That's your job. So set your target very clearly. And once you do that, you can tell them that this is the terms and conditions. We've already got this person in. How about you now, right? And do not go giving around different terms. You can be giving, you'll be facing a down round, and that's not advisable.
One quick plug for SLP here, if Anilkar can comment on that.
That's what I wanted to say. This is a perfect question, essentially, and it's a great pitch for SLP. So I can give my answer, but really there are multiple sessions where you sit down and have this negotiation. You play the role of the entrepreneur, which we are all, and then you play the role of a VC. You understand the dynamics. You understand who negotiates what. You also understand and learn what you need to negotiate and what you should not negotiate. Because when you get a term sheet, you need to negotiate no more than 3-4 things. If you do that, you lose it. But there are strategies in a way. And then SLP is a great mechanism to learn this. So you know how to approach that. Should I go on this? If you have only one investor, you may not be able to negotiate. But then what are the things that I can get out of that? And what is important and what is not important? Just knowing that is a very big deal. And SLP is great for doing this. It's the, there are whole sessions understanding and going through that. It's really different even as a game, as a simulation. You sit there and the pressure that dawns on you is amazing. You, it's just worth experiencing if, even if you're not going to do a startup. So,
very good. So I want to pull back and then talk about coming back to the notion of leadership, right? We heard so many examples here. There's a common, very common theme here of making decisions in uncertainty or with incomplete information. You're making a, either reading the market, deciding whether it's a pain point translates into a big opportunity, thinking under pressure, negotiating for the best outcome. It's all about making decisions, making good decisions, hopefully, but making decisions nonetheless. And that's all about startup leadership. So individually, if you can all comment 15 seconds or 20 seconds each, what does startup leadership mean to you? And what have you learned, for those who have done SLP, what have you learned from that program that helped you? And for those who have not, you've still learned out there, what have you learned about that?
Simple for me. So a friend of mine, who was an entrepreneur, had a successful exit, sold his company to Autodesk, and then founded his other company. The only thing that he said to his investors this round is, all I can say is, I'm not going to make the same mistakes I did last time. And we all make mistakes, we will make mistakes, because startups are a journey of ups and downs. You heard this, everyone is making mistakes. The biggest value of SLP for me was learning the potential pitfalls and the biggest mistakes that you can make, and learning from others' experiences, and at least you write off some mistakes without you actually doing them. It's a great value, because the other way is you just need to sit down and learn them by doing them yourself. That, I think, is the biggest thing. And this is across the board. What legal mistakes can you make? What co-founder decisions that you can make wrong? Term sheet mistakes you can do wrong? Your taxation, all the other things from different areas, even just eliminating the most obvious ones is so valuable, and you will get them all in SLP.
Sure.
The way I see SLP, especially for first-time entrepreneurs, is, let's say you have been working in a small or a large company throughout your whole professional career, right? I mean, you get used to certain kind of paycheck, you get used to certain kind of work style and all that. So that's one extreme, right? The other extreme is you leave your job and just jump into and do a startup, right? You leave everything, I'm going to tomorrow morning and I get up, I'll resign and I'll do a startup. So there are two extremes, right? SLP is a very, very good platform to connect the two. Especially, again, as I said, for first-time entrepreneurs, it gives you a good platform that for, like, say, 6 month period, right, while you are in your current job, but you are passionate about doing a startup and you have certain ideas that you have started developing, to actually spend the next 6 months with like-minded individuals, where you can start coming out of that comfort zone and into the reality of what a startup, building a startup means, right? Every class of SLP is geared towards one particular topic, at least a few years ago, right? It was like that. Is a very good speaker which comes, and again, that's kind of the SLP network and their class. They all work together to get a speaker. I remember that when in 2012 and 13, I got a speaker from the University of Pennsylvania, the Wharton School of Business, a guy who teaches entrepreneurship there, to come and give a 3-hour lecture on how to evaluate a term sheet, right? It's invaluable. I mean, if you do go out and do a course in such a prestigious university, it'll cost you maybe $5,000-$10,000, right? So every class is a learning experience, a new aspect. And then by the end of 6 months, right, you feel comfortable, you feel that you are at a level where you know now a lot more than what you would have learned just by reading. And that hopefully will put you in a state where you have a lot of kind of things working your way to kind of now take that plunge, right? So I think it's a great platform to make the transition from for a first-time entrepreneur.
So I completely follow the same comments that Tamer and Shiv said about SLP. The fact that there are all those lectures and by people that are very, very knowledgeable about the structuring of deals, the laws, or the marketing, or how do you go about hiring, or how do you go about building your team and growing it? How do you go about raising money and the practice, of course? All of those were very, very valuable to me. I didn't have any education or any even insight into the entrepreneurship world before I did it, even though I was like 3 years into the venture. The stuff that I think I learned the most from SLP is actually from the peers that were in my team. We were about 20. And I learned that my way of building a company is not their way. They could come up with and execute startups that I would never even begin to understand how to do it, how to do them, and they were fantastic in them. So I could see how every other entrepreneur in the room was using his or her strength to do a startup very different than what I would do. And that showed me also what could be the structure of my team, what could be the company that I will grow. It was something that really, without this, I would probably have done a million mistakes, and I would not feel confident in my way forward.
Great. Of course, you had unfair advantage in that almost with experienced advisor very close to you. But still, you learned on your own with firsthand. So if you can speak to that.
I think I was really fortunate actually working at Facebook right after school, especially because this is right when the company went IPO. So I got to see how they structured things and how the engineering teams were run. I think that really helped because like with that's one thing that definitely was different between the way that my dad and I think. Like the cycles are a lot longer in enterprise. So in consumer, you go through really fast. You know, Facebook's mantra, move fast and break things. But I think one advice that I definitely have for any entrepreneur is to fail early and fail often. You're gonna make mistakes no matter how much you read about stuff or ask people that are experienced. You're gonna make millions of mistakes. Just make them fast and just make sure you don't make the same mistake twice. I think that's the main thing. That's the best you can do. Like you can spend years, I think, trying to understand a market or understand, but you're not actually going to be able to identify what's going on unless you actually go out there and build it. So no matter how much you prepare, you're not going to be prepared for your entire startup. You're going to learn something new. Just learn it fast and be able to work with it.
And be very comfortable embracing failure, but learning from it.
Yeah.
Well said. Ashwin?
To me, startup leadership is smart, relentless execution. I can bore you with saying, you need to be inspiring, you need to be fair to your employees and all that. But think of what is a startup? You're really taking the next step. It's not about completing the whole journey. It's about taking that next step. It's a series of steps that you're going, and you need to take that next step. And it's about smart, relentless execution. I say that because nothing motivates people than moving forward, than progress for a startup. And if you don't do that, your own team is going to lose faith. We're not going anywhere. You know, what's happening? So if you can remember one thing, just do that. Keep executing and execute smartly.
Great advice. Jer?
I think a lot of it has already been said. So for those who are not fortunate, like myself, who have not been to the, the program, I just say surround yourself with people who are smarter than you, and Silicon Valley is a wonderful, wonderful place to do that. Attend as many events as possible. Learn from your lawyers, learn from your consultants, from your CFOs, or whoever who does your taxes and bookkeeping, et cetera, et cetera. And just ask people. So the startup world is like an unfinished puzzle, and every time you have a little hole over there, you meet somebody who can probably fill that hole with an idea for you. To ask them, what did you do when this happened, and they will just give you the answer right there and then. And kind of learn from it and kind of fill in all the blanks until you have a pretty good picture about what you want to do and how you want to, move on with your company for the better. And obviously, there is no way that you're going to avoid all of the mistakes. That's just impossible. But again, learn from your mistakes and try to make as many mistakes as possible, as quickly as possible, so that you can move on to the good stuff.
Great. I want to just quickly remind everybody to make sure that if you haven't signed into the sign up sheet, please do so, your name and especially your email address, so we can reach to you. But I have got to ask you this question.
Go ahead.
And it's a fundamental question that many can face. When you started out with deep learning, machine learning is the buzz and the craze, AI everywhere is. When you started out, you were early, and then it becomes possible through cloud and computational power and the advancement that now it's so accessible and everybody jumps on that, and so now you are one of many, whereas earlier you were ahead in some ways. And so that's a competitive advantage that somehow becomes difficult to maintain. If you can speak to that general notion.
So you do want to be, and that's a great point, you do want to be specialized. Even companies that don't do deep learning today, they put it on their websites and videos all over, and that's just, you know, the way it is, similar to machine learning, you know, a few years ago, et cetera. You just want to be as specialized as possible. So you know, there is AI, and then, you know, from AI, we use deep learning, but then it's deep learning for vision, and then it's not just vision, it's face analytics, and it's not just face analytics, it's emotion recognition. This is how many layers you kind of want to go through with being as specialized as possible. A perfect example would be, for example, for, you know, EEG. So we would like to do EEG in general, but then potentially later on, we would just want to focus on this particular symptom or this particular idea so that you don't find yourself with a lot of people. The more specialized you are, the more attention you have, and the more, you know, the bigger the leader you become in your space. And as you become, you know, specialized in what you do, believe me, there is always those who are just as interested in what your specialty is, and that just keeps you above the crowd.
Very well said. I just want to leave this notion with you also. Another dimension to that is form matters. How it's wrapped matters. How it's consumed matters. A personal example, I would never take the time to brew coffee and all of that. I like coffee, but I would never do that. But those Keurig cups, plug it in, it's there, and I drink coffee every day now. Nothing changed, really. It was just the way it was produced, and I could just consume it much, much more easily. So it's a notion where it's wrapped, specialized enough, and it's presented in a way that's easy to digest. I think that's part of the recipe that I think entrepreneurs have to, that puzzle that he talked about, right, that has to be sorted through. Well, great discussion. I want to bring this to a close now. And before I close, I do want to thank all the panelists for being here. Of course, thank all of you. But I think I hope you found their insights useful. I found it very fascinating because this is a collection, as I mentioned in the beginning, very diverse collection of startups with very diverse ecosystems. But there are common themes and common patterns that hopefully emerge from this. So thank you again. And
thank you for having us.
I actually want to have a little gift. So let me talk about this gift for the panelists. This is a book called Valley Speak. It came out recently. And this is co-authored by one of the SLP fellows, Steve Gans, and Rochelle Kopp. It's been written up in the Wall Street Journal. It's on the front page of San Jose Mercury News and many papers, Time, Fast Company, and so on. It's a lighthearted but rigorous overview of Silicon Valley's culture. Much of it, as you said, is around startups. And it focuses on the vocabulary, the language that people have to understand. It's very funny. It's very refreshing. But for those who are new to the Valley or those who are new to the startup scene, it's a great book. And it's not just a dictionary, right? It puts the terms in context. And one of the things that obviously is important to know when you're sitting across the table from a VC or in that ecosystem, what are they talking about? And what does that really mean for me? I think this is a great resource. So I'm very happy on behalf of Valley Speak and behalf of SLP and Ty to give this a copy of the book to each of you. That's the book.
Thank you.
All right. A big round of applause for the panelists.